Barbershop Podcast from Boxo Studio in Hamilton, Ontario. Each and every week, bringing you the very best in Hamilton music and musicians. And we don't miss a beat, do we, Ryan Cannon? I'm telling you, we are steady Eddie.
We certainly do not, yes.
You know what? Because it's thick. It's like going fishing in the times of Jacob. And you had to walk across the top of the water. The fishes were so plenty. It's like that in Hamilton, Ontario. If you want to come and experience what real live music is about, what real original, honest-to-goodness music is about, I don't think you can do better than Hamilton, Ontario. And we preach that. And, well, we've got a couple disciples this week, and they're going to kick ass, and they're going to rock your world, as they do to mine. Ryan Cannon, are you excited about tonight? Well, let's do a little preface. We got a little some changes here at Boxo Studio going on, don't we?
Yeah, we did. We got a new board. I'm sounding a little fucky, but yeah, we got a brand new board. I can probably show it to you. Maybe not. I'll take a picture and put it up later. But we got a brand new board. You can see it on the Facebook page.
Yeah, it was huge. It's a lot of work.
Yeah,
right?
It's a huge, huge upgrade.
You want to spend all your time plugging wires in instead, where you like got the saw out with the 2x4s because it was so big it didn't fit anywhere. So
yeah.
The cases don't fit anywhere. It's wonderful. You know, it's one of these monstrous old beautiful pieces of equipment. And you know what? We had a bit of a faux pas tonight. You know, tonight's guest, a great band, and I'm sure we'll be seeing more of them. But sometimes when things get crazy, things slip your mind. And
it happens to the best of us.
Even the best of us. But you know what? The Zills were supposed to be on tonight, and, you know, God love them. Forgot for some reason that they were supposed to be on the greatest podcast in rock and roll history. But I believe them that it was an honest mistake, and I am going to love this band continually and bring them back on. But we weren't going to leave a hole, and we weren't going to put in, you know, what, you and I babbling about our...
No, nobody wants to hear
Nobody wants to hear you and I anymore.
We've done that enough.
So we had to go out, and we had to get, like, the big harpoon, and we had to get, like, something that was, like, really, really good out there in Hamilton, Ontario. So if one was to go out at, like, 10 o'clock, you know, and find like two of the best singer-songwriter musicians in the entire, I would say, country, but we've got them in this hotbed of Hamilton, Ontario. Where would you go?
The Corktown Tavern. Where else are you going to go?
And that's where he went. It's the closest bar. It's been around Corktown. The Irish moved in there and made it their own, and I think there's still one or two Irishmen left in Corktown, but I tell you, the Corktown Tavern, it's got a long history of music and supporting music, and tonight... these gentlemen were in here, as they are on every Wednesday, and doing a beautiful job entertaining us. And we were able to cajole them to come back to the studio and keep our record of, what is this, 86 weeks in a row, Ryan
86.
Cannon?
86. I'm pretty sure it's 86.
Yeah. 80% of podcasts don't make it past 10 episodes.
We're way past that.
We're crushing it.
Way past that.
So I want to introduce, you know, let's go left to right because it's easiest. Andy Griffiths and Tomi Swick. Oh, man, I am so happy to have you guys in the studio. Barbershop Podcast, bringing some of the great talent from Hamilton, Ontario. You guys are both got your stories about Hamilton. Definitely, it's a big part of what your music sounds like, what you write about, what you feel. Let's get right into it. Let's talk about the early days. Let's start with you, Tomi. Did you come from a musical household, or was this something that was your own brand?
I came from a very musical household. My family immigrated from Scotland. Everyone played an instrument, played something, and as a kid, I grew up, I played piano, I played bagpipes, I was a singer in a church choir.
So you had bagpipes in the house?
Yeah, I played pipes, yeah, cool. When I was younger. I can't play them now, but I did then, yeah. And then just music was always a big part. I was into sports heavy, but music was always a huge part of
it. So you were fearless, like instrument was something to be attacked, and it didn't matter what it was.
I played everything by ear. I just picked up whatever instrument I picked up, I kind of got into and just played, and it always kind of worked out all right.
Yeah. So what was some of the first songs or some of the first groups that you remember distinctly? I remember a name.
I remember Good Golly Miss Molly.
Yeah.
Little Richard, I remember that as a kid. Sorry, I'm a bit of a cold.
You're a trooper. I'm glad you're in.
Good Golly Miss Molly, and then it was stuff like Beatles and Zeppelin, and just my family was weird. I grew up in a household full of traditional Scottish music, so old Scottish, like, you know, I don't know, Scots Way or like, you know, Flower of Scotland, all that kind of stuff all the time. But then also, like, you know, there's disco and folk. It's a big mix of everything growing up for me. So
right on. Yeah. What about you, Andy? Were you the prodigy, or were you the problem child?
A mix of both.
As every great artist
yeah.
is.
Yeah, well, you know, I actually didn't start till a bit later. My dad actually got into learning guitar, you know, later in life, and then that was probably around when I was 15 or something, and so I started picking up his guitar and kind of noodling a little bit here and there, and went on to... I became a big, huge fan of the Beatles. That's a classic story. And learned a whole pile of Beatles songs and Stones and all that stuff. And that's kind of what I grew up on.
How long did you play before you started writing your own stuff?
I guess I played for about 2 or 3 years, and then we kind of got right into it. I had a few friends from high school that were sort of, you know, had the passion just like I did. So we had our own little band and put together some songs. And
were you the same way, Tomi? You had like a group of friends that you started playing with?
Yeah, I had a bunch of goofy buddies that I played. I played sports. Like, I was always playing basketball, football, or soccer in school. And these newfie buddies that they're just hilarious guys. We partied like crazy, and
no doubt,
all school, yeah, it's crazy. And then we jammed all the time, and so we played at this place downtown where Leathers is.
Because you're a Hamilton boy, through and through.
Born and bred, yeah. I was born. I lived on the mountain until I was 13, and then moved down to Barton and Gage, and I went to Hill Park. For 1 year, so 14. I went to Hill Park for 1 year, and then moved downtown and went to Cathedral for the rest, and played football and basketball down there, and just jammed all around town as a kid.
Now, I feel like I have affinity with you, right? Because like as big guy who speaks his mind, people get their mind made up about you pretty quick, right?
I speak my mind, and sometimes people don't like it. A lot of people don't like what I say, but...
And I love sports, right? And a lot of times it was like, so many people who love sports don't get music, and so many people who are into music don't get sports, right? And there's always this core of people, it's like, you know, this person can walk comfortably. Did you find that there was like ever like... You felt at odds that there was between two camps?
I remember when I first started playing in Toronto tons, you know, it was all these like fashionable, you know, chic. And I walked in like a big donkey from Hamilton, smashing my guitar and playing love songs. And, you know, it wasn't all, I was playing a lot of rock back then. People don't realize that I grew up in rock. I was in a band called Red Echo in the 90s, late 90s, early 2000s, that we almost got signed by Sony, and we were like rock. Sorry. When I first started playing on my own name and going to all these different gigs, and people was like, what the hell, who is this dude, or what's this, you know, what's this guy about? Because, you know, I'm 6'3", you know, 250 pound ginger. And you know, playing, you know, songs, and it was weird for a bit, but I just kind of I just didn't care. I just played, you know. I was on a mission to kind of just demand respect, but to be like, you know, I can be here, I can hang here, and that was my whole goal, was to show up and play well.
Did you find that same, like, with your growth as a songwriter, when you started coming out, when you started playing other people's songs, that you had to start wearing this Superman cape?
Yeah, you know, it took me a bit longer to get used to that, because I was always pretty insecure about playing my own stuff. But lucky for me, over the years, I've been meeting people like Tomi and various others, mostly a lot from in and around Hamilton, a few from Toronto. And they've sort of helped me, you know, come out of my shell and you know, present my stuff with authority. And
that's come a long way from when I first met you.
Yeah, like even in the past 2 or 3 years, 4 years, I think I met you, what, 4 or 5 years ago?
At the West Town.
Yeah.
And again, I can't stress that too much. I've put on, as you did, you know, and you have open stage, and people will jump on, the haters will come on and say, well, you're not being, and they'll find all these reasons not to. Mm-hmm. But as a working musician, when you go out and you meet your community, and it's like, this is the fuel for
it's
you to go forward,
huge,
right?
Difference,
definitely. Yeah. Well, I play 25 gigs a month right now. I'm playing all the time, but I've been playing now. I'll be 34 on Friday, so, you know, technically tomorrow. And I've been playing full-time basically since I was 17, 18. So, I mean, the musical community that I grew up playing with, you know, it's vast, and there's so many great guys that you learn from, you know.
Who were the heavyweights in Hamilton when you were
coming
up?
For me, it was Brian Griffiths, Harrison Kennedy, Tom Wilson, all those guys, obviously those guys. But then I got, you know, Joel Gunther's a good friend of mine, Jesse O'Brien, you know, the Lapsleys, you know, there's so many bands, there's tons and tons of people, the Freedom Train guys, you know, like, those guys were huge for me.
Yeah.
I just kind of got, once people knew who I was, I kind of had a lot of people give me good advice, you know, and, you know, some people give me fucking pretty bad advice, but.
You find out both ways.
Oh, well, yeah, and I think I think I was giving myself some bad advice. No, like, there's so many great musicians. This place is chock full and spoiled beyond belief. Yeah. People don't realize how other cities do not have the depth of musicianship that this place does.
No.
Yeah. There's a ton of great musicians.
And you're a transplant. At what point did you come to Hamilton?
Well, you know, I live in Burlington, but as I started getting, I sort of ducked out of the music scene for a few years because I'm actually an architectural designer as well, so...
options over here.
Yeah.
I got my guitar.
I started a business. It absorbed a lot of time. There was family things and all that. So I kind of came back into things about 5 years ago with a mission. And my mission was to release an album. I released the album, had a show at the Studio Theater, which is an unbelievable venue.
Great venue.
And just before I released there, I started meeting people in and around, more people in and around Hamilton, and one of the people was Frank Corin.
And monster.
Yeah. Monster.
So, super nice guy, super guitarist, and he helped me put together a band for this show. And it was a phenomenal experience, and things just kind of went from there. So I sing a lot now with Kim Corin, and play with Frank, and it's just a riot.
Yeah, I'll announce this tonight. You know, Frank was, if not the first, the second person I called for the Exile on King Street show because he had to be in it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to be doing Exile on James Street at This Ain't Hollywood November 29th. We're going to be doing that whole thing again, and Mara's going to be singing with him.
Nice. Yeah,
doing
she's
Sweet Virginia.
Yep.
Just great musical family. It's like, you know, and... want to support what you're doing, and you've got some songs, and normally we come in here with a bunch of pre-recorded stuff, but you guys are just going to lay it down, and Tom, like, you're suffering from a bit of a...
I got some pretty bad bronchitis.
Some bronchitis going on right now, so when you hear him at 60% is like 110% of the average bear, so, you know, these guys together, it's great.
I wish I had his 60%.
Yeah, this is a bit of the magic. You can catch this kind of stuff, you know, look in your entertainment magazine, go online, come out to live music, you know, for the price of a movie, you're going to have a way better time. So, whip something up for us, guys.
Sure. Should I go first?
Sure.
I'll do a song. I'm working on a new record right now. It's pretty roots. I was kind of known for more pop stuff, even though it's not really what I ever really did. It's just kind of what happened with Warner. And I left them, and I started working on this new record with Dave King. He plays drums with Steve Strongman, and he's played with Harrison Kennedy and Griff and everybody for years. He's got a great studio called the Barn Window Studios up in Kaser Center, and I'm working out there. And there's a song I've been working on. It's called Bad Things.
Coming from the south, coming from all over, drown me out. Something in the air, something wrong round here. About the crazy and the pressure and the fear. Oh, there's bad things going on around here. And my body's running out of air. Life ain't nothing like what they say when you're just young. not a cold-hearted kind of way to start someone. It's like we're living in a jungle. Instead of lions, we got rules to follow. Yeah. Bad things going on around here. My body's running out of air. Bad things going on around here. My body's running out of air.
Absolutely believable, you know, and I think that's it. When you experience live music and you see someone testify and pour their heart out like that, I mean, you don't phone that shit in, right?
You think
that's your ticket? That separates you from the crowd?
I'm a very straightforward, honest guy, I think, and I know this has kind of become the cliche, but I'm brutally honest in my songs, and they're extremely, most time, pretty introspective, so I think... I just throw it all out there. And
do you have a lot of people come up to you and say, hey, you know, like, I identified with that? Like,
yeah, well, it depends on the song. But yeah, definitely. Because I don't write, for the most part, I mean, when the songs that I really love, not love my own, but the songs of mine that I like the best of mine are the ones that are the most truthful ones, obviously, you know, and so... Yeah, there's a lot of connection. It just depends on the crowd, I guess.
Yeah, you know, and you got to feel it, right? But you give what you get, right? Exactly. And I think that the performer is waiting for it to come there.
If you lay it all out there, somebody's going to get it.
Yeah. and the room with six people who are paying apt attention to you is worth more than the room with 70 people who are talking over
that's
you.
That's totally
that's true. Yeah.
Totally true.
You know, and as a songwriter, that's the real deal, right?
Yeah.
So tell me about, Andy, tell me about you, you know, as a writer. Do you tend to want someone who books a lot of songs and then picks through them, or do you, like, attack a song one at a time?
Yeah, I'm not that prolific. I spend a bit more time on individual songs. If it's not really, if I don't feel like it's going anywhere, I'll kind of let it go aside.
But you know it's got quality, so there's chunks of that you're gonna
Yeah, like I've got pages and pages and pages of lyrics, but when I know a song is actually happening, I'll sort of keep it on top and I'll keep on coming back to it.
Okay, is it ever come quick, or is it a different process?
Yeah, songs. Yeah, every once in a while, like, a great song comes quickly, and those ones are actually some of my more popular songs, as it were.
Well, spin one up for us.
Okay, let's try this one.
I mean, I love having you guys in here. Less talking, forever. More rocking. Barbershoppodcast.com.
So this one's called Gone Forever. It's sort of the happiest sounding sad song you'll probably ever hear. Okay, so let's start this way. Okay.
Night I said these words to you, my dear. Think I love you forever. Must have said something wrong with you. You left a note saying gone forever. Thought we had something right. right here. Must have been my imagination. Never thought it would end in tears. You left a note saying, gone forever, gone forever, gone forever, gone forever, gone forever. Myself in the mirror, looking deep, I see nothing wrong, but you left a note saying
my God, that was beautiful. I tell you, you know, this is the kind of stuff that I take for granted. I don't take for granted, actually. I've been like knee deep in it forever and ever. Yeah. And as long as I've been a musician, I've been a fan, you know, and I've been a bigger fan than I have been a musician, you know. And then,
likewise.
Yeah, you know, it's just, you're surrounded by it. And this is beautiful. This is the kind of stuff that every household should be listening to instead of the plastic wrapped crap that's kind of filtered down to you. You need to get to the real. So here's an opportunity. If you like this show, share it with your friends, okay? We're on YouTube. We're on iTunes. We're on Stitcher Radio. You can get this. You know, just Google Barbershop Podcast, and that shit's there, okay? And someone you know loves original music, real music, good music. All the people who are on this show, we put their links up where you can get a hold of them, where you can get a hold of their music. If you like what you hear, share it, okay? This is how the industry is built. It's through the support of the people who believe in it. And I want to say a couple shout-outs to my good friend Maggie, who's got HamiltonArtist.ca up and running, and next week she's going to be launching. If you want something printed on something, T-shirts, hats, buttons, mugs, you name it, she's the one to do it. We'll be running some ads starting next week. And my good friend Shelley Marshall, who is running a workshop at the Pearl Company this Sunday between 11 and 2. All these people, one thing we're going to touch on, you know, it's like, how do you promote yourself? You know, because there's no white knight. There's no one coming in and doing that. And Shelley Marshall has done a great job.
Shelley's a queen.
Yeah, she's a queen. It's like, how do you get yourself out there, and how are people going to know about it, right? And I'm going to be there, and I'm going to learn something. As much as I know, I know I don't know nothing. You know, the more the more you learn, the more you realize that. And life gets easier. You know, you stop fighting the fight, right?
Yeah, totally. Not only that, when you learn something, she's a riot.
Yeah.
Like, it'll be a fun
riot and a great person. Thing. So with Pearl Company, Sunday, July 20th, 11 a.m., 2 p.m., be there. All right. You know, I want to hear more music. I want to hear less of my voice and more of what you guys are doing, because I'm tingling right now. I think it's so great that you know, you're both you guys were on my list. It's like, this is someone I have to call, right? And it was just so perfect tonight.
Because,
yeah, I wanted to talk to Jim, and I said, let's go down and poach Tommy's night, right? And it's like, well, you know what? Let's just poach Tommy. let's get them both, right? He's got the Griff with him, you know, the Griff too. So do you have, you know, you're constantly writing. You're a pretty prolific writer, right?
Yeah.
Is there anything you want to kind of share with us that's kind of fresh and still wiggling from the womb?
I've been going through a lot in the last little while. I've just had a lot of health issues, and this is, you know, the result of it, this cold I've had. And I was just chilling, writing, trying to get through some pretty heavy stress. And I don't know, I started writing a song. I have this classical guitar that I sometimes jam on, and I started writing this little thing, so hopefully it sounds all right on acoustic. But I've never played this before anywhere, so I'll try it now.
Beautiful. Barbershoppodcast.com. You only get it here.
It's a song called Come Together. It's a little, I don't know if it's R&B-ish or what it is, but it goes. Sorry. Here we go.
It's THB.
Ever, so.
Look at that. Never played it before ever, and it's as beautiful as anything I've ever heard.
Yeah.
I say this every week. It's a world-class city. I mean, musically, it's a world-class city. And Tomi, like, you're certainly...
Thanks, man.
Like, you're fantastic.
Thanks.
And I want to touch on this because, you know, I've had, like, Tom and Rita and some big people with, like, careers in music, but most people are indie artists. You've got label experience. Tell me about life with a like when you're signed to a record label?
I was with Warner Brothers for almost 8 years. I put up 2 records with them. This is a lot of pros and a lot of cons, you know. It's
like, first of all, how did you get noticed by a record label?
I played like crazy. I've been playing full-time since I was about 16, 17. I started playing with Nathan Fleet. I don't know if you know him.
Yeah. Great filmmaker, too.
Oh, yeah. Nathan's my brother-in-law's brother, so he's my brother-in-law. And so I was a backup singer, rhythm guitarist for their band, Park Row, which is named after a street down the East End where they grew up.
I was right there.
And so I played rhythm guitar and sang backup for them, and I jammed in little bands before that. With my friends, my new few buddies, Jay Wood, Tom Bukulich, where are you?
They're gonna be watching.
Keith Reed, thank you guys. And so I played with them for a while, and then I just started playing with these guys. I did Jesus Christ Superstar down at Tivoli Theater with Lauren Lieberman.
Was that a buzz?
It was great. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. Try being a 6'3" big guy with all these little ripped little dancers trying to dance. I look like a giant octopus.
So you're Jesus? Was it?
I was in Jesus Christ Superstar.
What was your role though?
I was Judas. The Apostle John.
Okay.
And I sang a lot of the harmonies for the play with a great singer, Owen Welch, and Dave Riccatoni. We had a good time, and Lauren put on a great show. There's a lot of great people, a lot of Hamilton people who were in that group. Andrew Moha, tons of people were in that. Colin Lapsley, Michelle Titchen, just so many. And it was a really great show, and Tivoli was a lot of fun. And some of the guys in the pit band asked me if I'd one of the guys, Dave Romanello, asked me if I'd come and try out for his band, and I'd never done it before. I'd never fronted a band, and I was super scared. Now here I was as a jockey kind of dude, but I loved music. I was heavy into music. And so I went and tried out, and went well, and so I played with that band. We were called Nimbus, and then we were called Red Echo. We did that for a while. And then after that, I quit that after, it was like Limp Bizkit era and people wanted rap rock and this is not what we did. And sorry, we talked to Sony and it just didn't happen. So I was 20 at the time. And then I just wrote songs. I didn't really play much for a while until a girlfriend I was dating at the time just said, why don't you get off the couch and go play? And so I went down to an open jam night down at the Casbah when they first started having them, and there's all these people there, and I just got a really good response. The first time I played a bunch of new songs, and it just kind of snowballed pretty fast, because I played over the next few years. I was playing in a cover band called Atticus Radley at the time. We were playing all over town, and I started getting gigs in Toronto, getting asked to play opening gigs for like guys like Brian Byrne from My Mother Earth, Kim Bingham, who played with David Usher as Mud Girl, she was called. And then I started getting more and more gigs, and then I was in Toronto all the time, and I was playing at the Cameron House, and one day a guy came up to Ron Lapata, who is now the vice president of A&R at Warner Brothers, but at the time he was doing his own thing. He was a keyboard player in Jack Soul. He offered me a production deal with him and Simon Wilcox.
Right out of the blue.
Oh yeah, and it was him and Dave Wilcox's daughter Simon who signed me to a production deal first. And I talked to them, and I was talking to EMI Publishing, and I ended up not going with EMI. And then I played all these shows, and I opened for Brian Byrne from My Mother Earth again at the Rivoli a few weeks later. And Warner Brothers was there, and Jen Hurst was at Warner, who bought Billy Talent to Warner and a bunch of other bands. And they came up and we said, we'll give you $5,000 not to show anybody these songs, and we want to talk to you. And so I said, $5,000, all right. And so I just played. I played hundreds and hundreds, thousands of gigs eventually, and with Warner Brothers. They called me to the office and said, bring your guitar. So I showed up at Warner Brothers with my guitar at 11 a.m. in the morning. Brutal for me.
Yeah.
I hadn't sent anyone demos. I hadn't done anything like that, just from gigs. It was all playing hundreds of gigs. And they said, we want you to play. So they put me in front of the president and all the different people, head people, and I played 5 songs. And then they called me back like 2 weeks later, and they said the same thing. I showed up, and they brought the whole company out, like 200 people. I didn't have a PA or anything, just an acoustic. And I played another three or five songs, and then they offered me a record deal, and I signed it.
That's right out of a fucking movie, isn't it?
Yeah.
You got to say fuck, fuck, fuck at some point in time, because we're allowed to, so we have to. Yeah, and it's good. So don't hold it in. It's like a fart. You let the swears out.
And that's how it happened. So yeah, I did that, and I was with them for a long time. Sorry, this is a long-winded story. I was with them for 8 years. And I did 2 records, and the only thing that I regret is that I come, it's not that I have to be heavy or anything like that, but I definitely come from a more organic vibe of music, and the records that I did with Warner, the songs I'm really proud of, and some things were successful, but it was more, it was pretty processed, and it was never exactly what I was, yeah. And so I wrote the songs, and I just, I wish I had had the forethought, and I was really innocent as to studios. I never really recorded. I recorded some stuff, but I mean, now I have a far
You wish you had your raw tracks.
I just have a far better grasp. I just wish I had known more at the time. But I mean, yeah. There was a lot of opportunities. I was young and I was partying my brains out. I was fucking crazy. And, you know, I had a great opportunity and I went for a crazy ride for a few years, man. I toured all over the country, did lots of stuff. And, you know, the last record I did with them, I thought it was going to be a bit different, but I went to England. I did it with the producer, Chris Potter, who did all the Verve records and worked with McCartney, the Stones, did a bunch of stuff. And I ended up doing songs. I had guys from Oasis on the record. I had guys that are in the Gorillaz, guys, like, great guys. I did a duet with Julian Lennon. Like, I did a whole bunch of stuff. And, yeah. You know, when the record was time for the record to come out, it wasn't a record that I really was into because there's songs I liked, but it wasn't the record I thought I was going to do.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it came.
It's tough when it's got all of those beautiful trimmings on it to be able to say that's still not kind of like.
It just wasn't what I wanted. And, you know, there's some of the songwriting I'm proud of, but it's just, it's hard when, you know, the idea that you have doesn't come to the fruition that you're looking for. And, you know, it's an all learning process. And now, you know, it led me to where I am now doing, you know, more rootsy stuff. And it's funny, they would never let me produce my own stuff or whatever. Basically think I was trying to do something really heavy, and now I'm doing my own record. It's rootsy. It's a lot of roots, you know, the roots and soul kind of stuff. So,
Well, it's funny because it's, you know, like any relationship, they fall in love with you for a certain reason and then they want to change you. You know, there's an agenda.
They kind of wanted, like, they thought I was going to be kind of Buble-ish or more John Mayer-ish, and they pushed me that way for a long time. And, you know, both those guys are extremely talented, you know, and fucking rich.
Yeah.
I think you know, I have a grittier voice than that, and I think, you know, I'm still trying to find my way exactly where I fit in.
But, yeah, and you're still a young guy in this business.
So 30 over 34. No, I'm just happy. You know, I've had a lot of great opportunities and been able to do a lot of good things. And, you know, I'm starting from scratch again, and I've almost never felt better about where I am in my own music. So,
yeah, my Uncle Archie would say, life is grand as long as you don't weaken. Yeah. You know, and it's like, you have a couple of little steps, but, you know, stay strong. And you've been, like, stockpiling. You're going to, your record, tell me about your record. Is it close? Is it what have you got in the can?
What have I got
going
working on
forward?
Well, my track record isn't quite as glamorous as Tom's.
Oh, I realize that, but
I
it's
come
like
from the indie thing. Yeah. I did all of my projects myself, and sort of it again, it was an interesting ride because I got to know people kind of step by step. And, you know, starting basically with the Karen family and then carrying on from there. But, you know, the last record that I did had a lot of great people on it. Ray Ferrugia actually played drums on a few tracks. Astrid Young sang on a few tracks. So Tommy was kind enough to lend his voice to a few tracks. So there was a lot of people involved, and it was an incredible experience meeting all these people. And like, The amazing thing is, I'm not really a professional musician. I'm very passionate about music, and because I'm passionate about it, these guys relate to it, and they're quite happy to help.
It's so true.
It's like you said, things ring true. When someone, you see someone's doing it for the right reasons. I mean, you know, we were saying at early Corktown, you know, people can think you're an asshole or I'm an asshole, but if I do this for the right reason, you know what I mean? It's not, it's because it's, I can't really do anything else.
Yeah.
Really much. And, you know, Andy.
And that's kind of why we got along together is because he's.
When I first saw you, I could tell you were doing it from your heart. You know what I mean? That's the coolest thing you see. You can really, you know, see someone's into what they're doing.
Do you believe it? That's what it comes down to. It's like you can talk about flavors and colors and shades, but whatever style of music and whatever that guy or that girl is delivering, it's do you believe it? You know, and it's how willing are you to sell it and not sell it.
I'm a very shy person, actually, so I've had to learn to be a bit
more. Well, it's good. You project
outgoing.
Really well. Yeah. So give us another something.
This one's called Mind on Other Things. This was the title track off the last album, and it's for all the daydreamers out there.
You want to play it? Do you want me to play it again?
Yeah, sure.
I'll try it.
Yeah.
In a while, dust off the rest.
Can't go wrong.
It's been a long day, you know. I didn't get much done. I was feeling kind of tired. I was trying to focus, but all I could think about was writing your song. I got my mind on other things. I've got my mind on other things. I've got my mind on other things. Yeah, yeah. having trouble finding the time. I'm having trouble stretching my mind. 1 year passed, I'm feeling much better. 1 year more and I'm looking forward. Yeah, 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 yeah. I got my mind on other things. I got my mind on other things. Got my mind on other things. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. There are things I wanna do. There are things I gotta say, hey, there are things I wanna be soon, someday, yeah, yeah. Tired of the same old shit. I'm getting tired. It's time for a change. I'm getting tired. Wanna try something new? How about you? I see you sitting there thinking, thinking. He's right, you know. My life's in a bit of a rut. I gotta break out and try something brand new. Tell you what I like to do, it's quite simple. Just wanna play my guitar, have a good time. We're having a good time right now, that's for sure. I just wanna play some good songs with good rhymes. Yeah, yeah.
It was great.
Got it.
Indeed. There we go. Barbershop Podcast. Ryan Cannon, are you not like rocking out this evening? Riding that giant 34 channel board, listening to this kind of magic happening.
It's been fun. I've been bouncing around.
Been a slice.
I can see it.
I'm a gear fanatic, so I'm jealous.
He's great. He's standing on a chair. He's like standing over.
I realize now how valuable Gary is.
Yeah,
now that he's not here.
Like I said, it's a late night, early morning show. Appreciate everyone. We're gonna cut the chat down to the minimum because I want to get at least one more tune out of each one of you.
Sure.
And then we're gonna wrap it up and say, you know, we were lucky. You were lucky, and we're all lucky. Hamilton, Ontario. So, Tom, you got something for you? Do you want to rock out for us?
I'm trying to think what I'd like to do. I'd like to do a song called Liberty, but I don't know if my voice can handle it.
It's a good song. Tommy's got some wonderful songs coming up for this new album.
Yeah, you know, Tomi Swick, you know, we're going to have his links on there. It's like a great, 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 great original, beautiful jewel from Hamilton, Ontario. And
well, hopefully, you know. Hopefully people that dislike some of my point of views will realize that, you know, I'm just a hardworking guy. I'm a hardworking musician, and you know, you're not always gonna agree with what I have to say, but I do it for, you know, it's coming from the right place.
Right. Yeah, and you can't make this shit up. You can't fake this.
slower version of it just because my throat's a little, a little messed up. This is a song called Liberty. It's killing me.
Good, beautiful music. Hamilton, Ontario's own Tomi Swick.
Thanks.
Yeah, oh, man. Appreciate you guys coming this late hour.
Thanks for having us.
No, yeah, man, it's always good.
I watched the show, so
thanks
it's cool,
for
man.
The invite.
It's always good. It's up forever. You never
sorry
be, you never
about
be,
the
yeah.
coughing. I
you'll be healthier,
guys.
But you'll never be younger.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So that's good. So what are you going to wrap it up tonight with us, Andy?
Tommy suggested I play this song. This is
a new one. It's a new baby.
New one, yeah. It's getting ready to be recorded.
We like that here at Barbershop Podcast. Something fresh.
Yeah. this little story behind this song is that when I was first learning guitar, the first guitar my dad had was a Stella, Harmony Stella, or Stella Harmony. I'm not sure which way that goes, but not sure who owned what at the time. But anyway, it was a neat little guitar, but those guitars were made for, they were made very cheaply and they were sold very cheaply, and the necks bowed and it was very hard to play, and I eventually got rid of that and bought another guitar and kind of worked my way up to nice guitars. And I kind of regret, in a way, selling my first guitar that I learned on. So I had this idea that I would go and hunt around for a similar guitar, like basically the same model. And I was looking around. I came close a couple of times, but not quite the right one. And then there's a place called Curry's Music and Collectibles up in Gravenhurst. And I saw on his website that he just happened to have exactly the guitar that I had. So I thought, oh, wow, that's great. So
beautiful.
I called,
road trip, too.
Called him up. Well, I called him up and I said, I got to have that guitar. And how is it and stuff? And he said, the neck's perfect. It sounds great. It's in perfect condition. It's hardly ever being played. It's like a under-the-bed closet case find. So I said, okay, I'll buy it. And it was like $180 or something. So it was a great deal. Awesome. So I'm thinking, how am I going to get this? Because it is a road trip up there, and I was kind of busy at the time. And it just so happened that I found Tom Wilson was playing next door. And as you know, Tom collects a lot of vinyl. Well, Curry's Collectibles has a lot of vinyl there. So Tom was spending like all his sort of free hours over there looking through the vinyl. So I just texted him and he said, would you mind grabbing this guitar while you're there? And he said, yeah, sure, no problem. So he brought it down for me, very kind of him, and grabbed the guitar. And that night I wrote this song. And this is one of those songs that just kind of went, blah.
These are the beautiful ones.
Yeah. This one's called Stella.
Some things were meant to be, like the day that you found me again. We parted ways, many years have passed. Now you're back. I was minding my own business, just thinking about love and forgiveness, when you appeared to me online. What a time, but I have to make you mine again. Come to me, baby. You down. Now in my arms you'll stay. We'll turn that frown upside down. Make some sound. We'll paint the town again. Can't you see? I need you in so bad, cutting like a knife.
Oh my God, that's good.
Yeah.
Thanks for
Oh, we're all timing it. Like we're old, so we're happy. We're just not peeing our pants when we do that. Oh my God, each and every week we got some incredible music in here at Barbershop Podcast. Tonight is no exception. These guys could literally go on all night, but we're not going to let them. That's all you get. You want to support these guys, come out and see them live.
Come on up.
Buy their CDs. Look them up, okay? You know, Andy Griffiths and Tomi Swick, killer Hamilton artists. Got a lot of them here. Follow them. Follow us at Barbershop Podcast. Guys, thanks so much for coming out. For Ryan Cannon.
Oh, yes.
Thanks, Ryan.
For Ryan Cannon.
Thank you.
Good job tonight, my friend.
Thanks.
We pulled that out, right?
Yeah, I wore two hats tonight, but yeah, I pulled it off.
You wore at least two hats tonight.
Yeah.
One of them was on your head anyway.
Working triple duty.
Yeah, triple duty. Yeah.
BarbershopPodcast.com. See you next week.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.